Right teaching and right learning. A good teacher clarifies his own ideas and strengthens them by teaching them. Teacher and pupil are alike in the learning process. They are in the same order of learning, and unless they share their lessons, conviction will be lacking. A good teacher must believe in the ideas he teaches, but he must meet another condition. He must believe in the students to whom he offers the ideas. Many stand guard over their ideas because they want to protect their thought systems as they are, and learning means change. Change is always fearful to the separated, because they cannot conceive of it as a move towards healing the separation. They always perceive it as a move toward further separation, because the separation was their first experience of change. You believe that if you allow no change to enter into your ego, you will find peace. This profound confusion is possible only if you maintain that the same thought system can stand on two foundations. Nothing can reach spirit from the ego, and nothing can reach the ego from spirit. Spirit can neither strengthen the ego nor reduce the conflict within it. The ego is a contradiction. Yourself and God's self are in opposition. They are opposed in source, in direction and in outcome. They are fundamentally irreconcilable, because spirit cannot perceive and the ego cannot know. They are therefore not in communication, and can never be in communication. Nevertheless, the ego can learn, even though its maker can be misguided. He cannot, however, make the totally lifeless out of the life given. Spirit need not be taught, but the ego must be. Learning is ultimately perceived as frightening because it leads to the relinquishment, not the destruction, of the ego, to the light of spirit. This is the change the ego must fear, because it does not share my charity. My lesson was like yours, and, because I learned it, I can teach it. I will never attack your ego, but I am trying to teach you how its thought system arose. When I remind you of your true creation, your ego cannot but respond with fear. Teaching and learning are your greatest strengths now, because they enable you to change your mind and help others to change theirs. Refusing to change your mind will not prove that the separation has not occurred. The dreamer who doubts the reality of his dream, while he is still dreaming, is not really healing his split mind. You dream of a separated ego, and believe in a world that rests upon it. This is very real to you. You cannot undo it by not changing your mind about it. If you are willing to renounce the role of guardian of your thought system, and open it to me, I will correct it very gently, and lead you back to God. Every good teacher hopes to give his students so much of his own learning, that they will one day no longer need him. This is the one true goal of the teacher. It is impossible to convince the ego of this, because it goes against all of its own laws. But remember that laws are set up to protect the continuity of the system in which the lawmaker believes. It is natural for the ego to try to protect itself once you have made it, but it is not natural for you to want to obey its laws unless you believe them. The ego cannot make this choice because of the nature of its origin. You can, because of the nature of yours. Egos can clash in any situation, but spirit cannot clash at all. If you perceive a teacher as merely a larger ego, you will be afraid, because to enlarge an ego would be to increase anxiety about separation. I will teach with you, and live with you, If you will think with me, but my goal will always be to absolve you finally from the need for a teacher. This is the opposite of the ego-oriented teacher's goal. He is concerned with the effect of his ego on other egos, and therefore interprets their interaction as a means of ego preservation. I would not be able to devote myself to teaching if I believed this, and you will not be a devoted teacher as long as you believe it. I am constantly being perceived as a teacher either to be exalted or rejected, but I do not accept either perception for myself. Your worth is not established by teaching or learning. Your worth is established by God. As long as you dispute this, everything you do will be fearful, particularly any situation that lends itself to the belief in superiority and inferiority. Teachers must be patient and repeat their lessons until they are learned. I am willing to do this, because I have no right to set your learning limits for you. Again, nothing you do, or think, or wish, or make, is necessary to establish your worth. This point is not debatable except in delusions. Your ego is never at stake, because God did not create it. Your spirit is never at stake because He did. Any confusion on this point is delusional, and no form of devotion is possible as long as this delusion lasts. The ego tries to exploit all situations into forms of praise for itself, in order to overcome its doubts. It will remain doubtful as long as you believe in its existence. You who made it cannot trust it, because in your right mind you realize it is not real. The only sane solution is not to try to change reality, which is indeed a fearful attempt, but to accept it as it is. You are part of reality, which stands unchanged beyond the reach of your ego, but within easy reach of spirit. When you are afraid, be still and know that God is real, and you are His beloved Son, in whom He is well pleased. Do not let your ego dispute this, because the ego cannot know what is, as far beyond its reach, as you are. God is not the author of fear. You are. You have chosen to create unlike Him, and have therefore made fear for yourself. You are not at peace because you are not fulfilling your function. God gave you a very lofty function that you are not meeting. Your ego has chosen to be afraid instead of meeting it. When you awaken, you will not be able to understand this, because it is literally incredible. Do not believe the incredible now. Any attempt to increase its believableness is merely to postpone the inevitable. The word inevitable is fearful to the ego, but joyous to the spirit. God is inevitable, and you cannot avoid Him, any more than He can avoid you. The ego is afraid of the spirit's joy, because once you have experienced it, you will withdraw all protection from the ego, and become totally without investment in fear. Your investment is great now because fear is a witness to the separation, and your ego rejoices when you witness to it. Leave it behind. Do not listen to it and do not preserve it. Listen only to God, who is as incapable of deception as is the spirit He created. Release yourself and release others. Do not present a false and unworthy picture of yourself to others, and do not accept such a picture of them yourself. The ego has built a shabby and unsheltering home for you, because it cannot build otherwise. Do not try to make this impoverished house stand. Its weakness is your strength. Only God could make a home that is worthy of His creations, who have chosen to leave it empty. by their own dispossession. Yet, his home will stand forever, and is ready for you when you choose to enter it. Of this you can be wholly certain. God is as incapable of creating the perishable, as the ego is of making the eternal. Of your ego you can do nothing to save yourself or others, but of your spirit, you can do everything, for the salvation of both. Humility is a lesson for the ego, not for the spirit. Spirit is beyond humility, because it recognizes its radiance, and gladly sheds its light everywhere. The meek shall inherit the earth because their egos are humble, and this gives them truer perception. The kingdom of heaven is the spirit's right, whose beauty and dignity are far beyond doubt, beyond perception, and stand forever as the mark of the love of God for His creations, who are wholly worthy of Him, and only of Him. Nothing else is sufficiently worthy to be a gift for a creation of God Himself. I will substitute for your ego, if you wish, but never for your spirit. A father can safely leave a child with an elder brother, who has shown himself responsible, but this involves no confusion about the child's origin. The brother can protect the child's body and his ego, but he does not confuse himself with the father, because he does this. I can be entrusted with your body and your ego, only because this enables you not to be concerned with them, and lets me teach you their unimportance. I could not understand their importance to you, if I had not once been tempted to believe in them myself. Let us undertake to learn this lesson together, so we can be free of them together. I need devoted teachers, who share my aim of healing the mind. Spirit is far beyond the need of your protection or mine. Remember this. In this world you need not have tribulation, because I have overcome the world. That is why you should be of good cheer.